Hello, this is Pastor Sandra Kennedy here at Whole Life Ministries in Augusta, Georgia. I am rejoicing over the goodness of God. God has given me a series of messages over Luke chapter 1 and chapter 2 that reveal to us patterns in the first coming of the Lord that has to do with the second coming of the Lord. They are so exciting. I pray that you will be tuned to all of the messages and you will pay close attention, because I want you to know and I want you to understand from the depths of your being, Jesus is coming, and He's coming very quickly, and He's showing us patterns of His first coming that you and I can pull out and see and pay attention, because they're happening right now as He returns, and He's showing us how to look for Him and how to prepare for His returning. I believe you will be so blessed. I'm thrilled over the opportunity to share these messages with you. God bless you, and get ready to be excited about the message. Okay, you have your Bibles? Let's go to Luke chapter 1. Luke chapter 1. Glory to God. Now, the title of this message today, it's a long one, but the title of the message is Hidden in His First Coming, Pattern for His Second Coming. We are going to be in the book of Luke. Basically, in the first couple of chapters. And we're going to discover, the Lord said He's going to show us patterns about His first coming that will set you up to know and to help identify the second coming and to know where we are. Oh, glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. And you will discover that in that account, in the Gospel of Luke, in the first couple of chapters, in the Gospel of Luke, in the account of the birth of the Lord, Jesus into His humanity is hidden the pattern for His second coming. Wow. Now, I'm telling you, you're talking about somebody getting excited. I've been excited. In Luke, let's go to Luke. Let's go from Luke 1 through 25. Luke 1:1-25. Inasmuch as many have undertaken to compile an account of the things accomplished among us, just as they were handed down to us by those who from the beginning were eyewitnesses and servants of the word, it seemed fitting for me as well, having investigated everything carefully from the beginning, to write it out to you in consecutive order, most excellent Theophilus. Now remember, this is Luke who's written this book. Luke has written it. So that you may know the exact truth about the things you have been taught. Luke wrote Acts. And the two kind of fit in there together, okay? In the days of Herod, king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah of the division of Abijah, and he had a wife from the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. They were both righteous in the sight of God, walking blamelessly in all the commandments and requirements of the Lord. But they had no child, because Elizabeth was barren, and they were both advanced in years. Now it happened that while he was performing his priestly service before God in the appointed order of his division, according to the custom of the priestly office, he was chosen by lot to enter the temple of the Lord and burn incense. And the whole multitude of the people were in prayer outside at the hour of the incense offering. And an angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing to the right of the altar of incense. Zechariah was troubled when he saw the angel, and fear gripped him. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah, for your petition has been heard, and your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you will give him the name John. You will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord, and he will drink no wine or liquor, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit while yet in his mother's womb. And he will turn many of the sons of Israel back to the Lord their God. It is he will go as a forerunner before him in the spirit and power of Elijah, to turn the hearts of the fathers back to the children, and the disobedient to the attitude of the righteous, so as to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. Zechariah said to the angel, "How will I know this for certain? For I am an old man, and my wife is advanced in years." The angel answered and said to him, "I am Gabriel, who stands in the presence of God. And I have been sent, I have been sent to speak to you and to bring you this good news. And behold, you shall be silent and unable to speak until the day when these things take place, because you did not believe my words, which will be fulfilled in their proper time." The people were waiting for Zechariah and were wondering at his delay in the temple. But when he came out, he was unable to speak for them. And they realized that he had seen a vision in the temple, and he kept making signs to them and remained mute. When the days of his priestly service were ended, he went back home. After these days, Elizabeth, his wife, became pregnant, and she kept herself in seclusion for 5 months, saying, "This is the way the Lord has dealt with me in the days when he looked with favor upon me to take away my disgrace among men." Now, you understand that in this first part from chapter 1 through the fourth verse, in those verses, the introduction, Luke makes it abundantly clear that he has investigated, interviewed, talked to anybody and everybody who is still living about Jesus and what has taken place during all of that time. And he's tried to make an exact account of what he was told by all the people who witnessed Jesus and who was there. Now, in the days of Herod, let me remind you what we're doing. We're saying in the first coming of Jesus, there is a pattern to show us about the second coming. Now, the Lord would not be telling his precious church about this if times were not near and the times were not ready, and it's about time for the time to be fulfilled. Do you understand that? So he wants the church, you, his disciples, the church whom he loves, he wants you to listen, and he's going to give you nuggets so that we can interpret the times we're living in. Amen. And we can really see that Jesus sincerely is coming back. And coming back very soon. Now, if you know the Word of God, you know he talks about in the New Testament over and over again to keep looking up. Keep expecting the Lord. Look with expectancy for the Lord. Amen. Keep expecting him to return. And over again, the disciples talk about what kept them steady in the boat was they expected the return of the Lord. They talked about the coming of the Lord. They were constantly mentioning, and it was a key in many things that held them tightly together. They're talking about, looking for, and expecting the return of the Lord. So if you were the devil, what would you do? Exactly what the devil has done. Make even God's people get tired of hearing it. Make even God's people say they've been saying that forever, so that you don't even pay attention anymore to signs of the coming of the Lord. Now, you have to remember that when Jesus came the first time, no one was looking. And yet they all had prayed every day of their life for him to come. That was in part of their prayers, that he would come. Years and years and years, prayers went forth on a daily basis for the Messiah to come. And when he showed up, there were not a handful of people who knew it, who saw it, who expected it, who recognized it. Now, let me remind you that during that time, that Roman rule was in order, and that Sadducees and Pharisees were like two political parties. Both were very wealthy parties. Both were very treacherous in the way they dealt with people. Within each of them, of course, more so in the Pharisee group, there were those who were really tuned to the Lord. Now, they were not tuned to his coming, but they were, quote, more religious than some of the other. Maybe I could put it more conservative than some of the others. Now, the Sadducees did not even believe in the resurrection. They didn't even believe in angels. And so you've got two, both of them under Roman rule, and the Sadducees were basically more so than the Pharisees, but they both were there. The Sadducees were completely, basically ruled and had their allegiance to the Roman government, or to controlling everything. As it was in his first coming. There are patterns to look for when he returns. Now, he was born into a very troubled and very fearful time in Israel. But before that, a forerunner had to come, as he had prophesied to Isaiah. Now, when I tell you these things, you're going to get so excited. So an elderly country priest and his wife lived in a village of Ein Kerem outside of Jerusalem. They were nobodies. And more than that, they were senior citizen nobodies. When the time came for the Father to send his Son to earth, he spoke first to senior citizens. You better be paying attention. Now, you young ones, you get in here. But I'm talking, these are serious things. I'm saying to you, when the time came for the Father to send his Son to earth, the first people he spoke to about it were senior citizens. Jesus is coming. Now, Zechariah's doubt is completely understandable. This is the first time, wrap your mind around this, pay attention. Wrap your mind around this. This is the first word from heaven in 400 years. No one had a word from God in 400 years. He did not have the internet to go to. He did not have any of his friends anywhere around. He did not hear somebody cross town. He knew of no one who had heard from God Almighty in 400 years. Now, how would you feel if an angel, he knew of no one who'd seen an angel in 400 years? No one who could come and say, can you believe what God said? No one could say that to him. He had nowhere to turn. And then an angel shows up, and not only, it's an archangel. It is Gabriel who stands in the presence of God, who shows up. Would you think you were hallucinating? Would you think you were losing your mind? Would you just buy it instantly? Don't act so holy. You don't even buy what's happening now. This is one of the most beautiful afghans you will ever have in your life. We wanted to open it up so you could see the full dynamics of it. I want to remind you that this design that the Lord gave me in an open vision back years ago in North Carolina, and with a dove flying through the air with healing streamers, the scriptures on the healing streamers, it's just precious. I saw people loose their faith and turn it loose as they grabbed hold of this. We've already prayed over it with all from Israel. We've already anointed it with the oil, and we've already laid hands on it. So many people have. And we've had so many reports where people were able just to loose their faith as they grabbed hold of it. Plus, it's absolutely gorgeous. It's our product for this month. It's wonderful. You'd want many a person to have it. I keep it on my bed. It's beautiful. And guess what? It just puts you in the presence of God, and you wrap yourself in the Word of Almighty God. Now, there are seven things we learn about Zechariah in Luke's account. One is, he was a priest at the time that there were some 20,000 priests in Israel. He was from the division of Abijah. You find that out in 1 Chronicles 24. He was from the tribe of Levi. He was blameless before God. He was the first person in the New Testament to ever speak with an angel. All these things are important. Every single one of them is important. He was old and childless. He'd prayed for a child, as implied in Luke 1. He doubted the angel at first because of his natural condition. Zechariah is kind of overlooked in the Christmas story. And that's crazy because it begins with him. The entire Christmas story begins with Zechariah. It didn't begin with Jesus. It began with Zechariah for the forerunner to come. It began with senior citizens who were nobody, that were from a town. Matter of fact, had it not been for this event, no one would know who Elizabeth and Zechariah is. No one. They were just there. He was called to the impossible at an impossible age with a wife who had an impossible womb. I'm going to repeat something because the Lord kept repeating it to me. When the time came for God to send his son into the world, he spoke first to senior citizens. So senior citizens, to everyone over the age of 55, are you ready for God to call you to the impossible? Because he's about to do it.
Praise God.
And to those under 55, stay calm. Because your part of the story is coming. It's not here today, but it's coming. There is a time and a season for everything. And it takes but a throwing of a switch for that time to be here.
Amen.
Now, we are living in the season of the return of the Lord. We're just waiting for the time.
Amen.
Did you hear me?
Yes.
And the Lord loves for us to talk about, I'm believing he's coming back.
Amen.
That's a faith statement. I believe he's coming.
Amen.
So Zechariah's doubted what he heard, just as you have. And then he questioned the angel and gave all the reason why it must be impossible. Zechariah said, I am old. The angel said, I am Gabriel. Says, who are you going to believe, Zechariah? Your natural circumstances are the one who stands before the presence of God.
Amen.
Church, this is where we are today. I don't know if you're hearing the message. I don't know if you're really hearing me. See, the challenge to us today who are looking for his return, it's not any different than Zechariah's. Do you believe what you see with your natural eyes or what you hear with your natural ears? Or do you believe the word of the Lord as it comes to you in this season? We're in a season where the books of Daniel have been opened. Revelation knowledge is coming forth. So are you going to believe the word of the Lord in the season, or are you just going to believe what you personally can see and you personally can hear? In all honesty, we have it better than Zechariah had it. Everybody in the sound of my voice, we have it better. Everybody does. The message God brought was the first word from heaven in 400 years. Heaven had been shut tight for 400 years. You, beloved disciples, have been hearing from heaven continuously. How much more should you believe and embrace what God is saying in this hour?
Wow.
Zechariah's unbelief yielded him an inability to speak. Unbelief always carries that discipline with it. Unbelief makes you unable to speak what the Lord is saying. Unbelief makes you say the opposite of what God is saying, or the very least unbelief makes you water down what God has said, scared to say it as strong as he says it. And I have promised I'd say it like I heard it. Unbelief will lead you to rationalize and analyze with a natural mind, and it will talk you right out of faith. There are three things he's doing. I mean, I've been telling you a whole bunch of them. Well, here's three more. He's doing unusual things with unusual people in unusual ways. Every time we gather, those three things are happening. I can't speak for everybody else. I can only speak for here. Every time we gather, in the last 6-8 months or so, or year, particularly the last 8 months, unusual things have happened with unusual people. I'm an unusual person. How about you? And they've been happening in unusual ways. Gabriel was not sent, and you need to hear this. I'm coming to a close. Gabriel was not sent to Zechariah because he was the holiest of the priests, or because he was the most righteous. There was nothing about Zechariah, nothing he ever did in his life that earned him the right to have this visitation or to become the father of John the Baptist. Nothing. You can find nothing about him that earned him anything. You can find nothing about you that earned God's grace on your life.
Amen.
Nothing about you that made God take you and bring him to himself.
Amen.
Nothing about me or you that made God forgive us.
Yes.
Nothing. It was purely and entirely God's choice for God's reasons. He does not have to explain anything to anyone. Why he chose to use whomever. And you don't have a right to judge it. Over the next few weeks, as you increasingly learn the patterns that God has hidden in the first coming of Jesus, is this not exciting? This is so exciting to me, I can hardly stand it. I have prayed for years to have some kind of insight. Over the next few weeks, as you increasingly learn The patterns that God has hidden in the first coming of Jesus. You're going to find some as you study and get before him. I'm expecting to find tons more. You will be equipped to recognize more accurately what your Father's doing at this time. Interesting sentence. At this time, to keep you from missing your moments. Moments. Things are happening so fast, we have to pay attention to our moments of opportunities, our moments that God puts you in, our moments that come before you. Don't miss your moments. Senior citizens, your life is not over, nor has your destiny been fulfilled. Young people, nurse your enthusiasm, but temper it with humility, for your place in the preparation for the Lord's return is critical. It's vital and precious, as was Mary's. The Father is about the business of preparing all of the Lord's disciples, young and old, for what he is about to do. Learn this from Zechariah. God is moving among his people. God is doing so in unusual ways. He is looking for those who will flow with him and trust him, especially in the unusual and the unexplainable events. We're talking about God's timing. We're talking about strange things are happening. Strange things are happening in the church. Jesus is coming. There are outstanding patterns, the Lord said, in the first coming of Jesus that show the patterns for his second coming. And you are to look and to learn and to be ready for his appearing. Glory to God.